Okay, Squid wishes you a happy equinox. And coming up next is the Dream Journal.
Sweet dreams till sunbeams find you. Sweet dreams that leave all worries behind you. But in your dreams, whatever they be, dream a little dream of me.
Good morning. You are listening to KSQD Santa Cruz, KSQD 90.7 FM, streaming live at ksqd.org. I am Katherine Bell, and this is the Dream Journal, a weekly show where we explore the healing powers of your nighttime dreams through conversations with dream experts and with you.
Stars fading, but I linger on, dear, still craving your kiss.
In the words of Carl Jung, who looks outside dreams, who looks inside awakens. Have you found that dreams sometimes prepare you for things to come? Today we have with us again our wonderful Lauren Schneider. Her book about the tarot is coming out soon, and we'll talk about that. Also, we'll get into precognitive and collective dreams. This is Katherine Bell of Experiential Dreamwork, and welcome to the Dream Journal. The Dream Journal is also a podcast, so you can look for that on all your regular podcast places and also on the KSQD website, where you can find it at ksqd.org/the-dream-journal. Oh, starting with my personal dream work. You know, what is up for me right now? I'm going to take a minute and listen to Rick Kleffel's music in the background. It always helps me relax and be present. So I'm taking a minute even to feel into my belly, to notice what's there and feel that relaxation moving through me. So I'm just going to say a few words about, I'm doing some writing lately, and I'm doing a workshop this month called Dreams and Spirituality, which has been really amazing for me. And it comes down to, how do we define spirituality? And in fact, even Wikipedia has this great comment in their Wikipedia page about spirituality, which says that, you know, the definitions encompass a wide range of concepts with limited overlap, which is, I think, a beautiful way of saying that. It's incredibly personal, and I have come up to the idea that something is spiritual if you say it is. You know, full stop. That's it. And if you believe it is and it feels spiritual to you, then it is. It doesn't have to be, you know, sanctioned by your dream guru or any religion or anybody else. That we get to choose what's spiritual. And, you know, even if this moment is spiritual, then it is. And, you know, that's the beauty of mindfulness, of bringing spirituality to every moment. Yeah, so that's my dream check-in. That's what I've been mulling over lately. So today, as usual, I will be inviting call-ins during the last 20 minutes of the show, so you can get ready for that. You might want to jot that number down now. It's 831-900-5773. That's 900-KSQD. You can share a dream or ask a question. You can save that number and call in about 35 minutes. That number again is 831-900-5773. So we have today with us Lauren Schneider. Hello, Lauren.
Hi, Katherine.
Hi.
So good to hear you.
Yeah, good to have you here again. I think this is your third appearance.
Yes, thank you for having me on again.
Always a treasured guest. Lauren Z. Schneider has been a psychotherapist, consultant, author, trainer, and group facilitator for 3 decades. She pioneered an innovative approach to spiritual psychotherapy through dreamwork and therapy. Lauren lectures worldwide, facilitates workshops and ongoing dream and therapy groups for therapists and laypersons. Over many years, she has paid particular attention to prescient dreams, which offer insight and guidance on collective issues, relationship dynamics, and navigating life from birthing to death. So, Lauren, what's been happening for you lately? Like, what is... Where do you want to start? That's the neat thing about having repeat guests is we don't have to go into, well, I mean, I always enjoy going into the background of people, but, you know, we've heard some of the stories from Lauren, and where are you at right now? Let's just start with the present.
Well, it's a very powerful time for me at the moment, as big transitions are. My mom just passed away, I'm very comforted by not only my dreams that helped me to prepare for this transition, but her dreams, listening to her dreams. And you were talking about spirituality. We can get into maybe, I mean, there's all kinds of things to talk about in terms of precognitive and prescient dreams. I would like to share maybe now or toward the end a prescient dream that she had that was an end-of-life dream and has been incredibly comforting.
Well, let's go with that. Because whatever's most present for you right now, Lauren, you can choose.
Okay. So, yeah, I was going to just say, because we're looking at this overall topic of precognitive dreams, and I want to just sort of frame that by saying that our conscious mind has concepts of time, linear time, and space in order for us to navigate this material world. But at the unconscious level, there is no time and space. There's no boundaries in time and space. So we can have dreams of what's happening, what's going to happen in the future, because dreams come for our well-being, also for the well-being of the species and the planet, to prepare us. And we can have dreams of one another, because at the level of the unconscious, we're all connected.
Right.
We can have dreams of what's happening in our culture and in the environment. And these precognitive dreams can be anywhere from very practical problem solving, everyday problem solving, to sublime and deeply spiritual.
Right. Well, Lauren, can I start by getting a definition? Like, what is prescient and precognitive dreams, and are they the same thing, or is there are you making a distinction, or are they similar terms for the same thing?
I think they're similar terms for the same thing. When I think of prescient, I think of something with wisdom. You know, something that is helping us to become more emotionally prepared for something. When I think of precognitive, it's basically just telling us something that's going to happen.
I see.
But I don't distinguish them in a great way. So I thought I'd just start with a very practical precognitive dream that I had when I needed a problem solved. And this is what I call the psychic internet. The fact that
the psychic internet.
When we're dreaming, we're tapped in just the way you and I are right now. We can tap in with each other at that same level. We can tap in with information that's in the collective. So this was a very practical issue. I, years ago, was driving a minivan when I had small children, and after a couple of years was tired of driving a minivan and wanted to get a small car but with at least 7 seats, because I was still carpooling. That car didn't exist on the market yet. So I kept looking and looking and looking. The day I had to give back the minivan, I had a dream. And it was just a license plate in front of my face with the word Buick on it in big, bold letters. I woke up, told my husband the dream, and said, but I don't like American cars. Why couldn't it have said Lexus?
Right.
And he said, now, you know your dreams. As my husband now knows my dreams, he said, you've got to go look at the Buicks. I don't like American cars. But I went to the lot. The man said, I don't have anything that you would want, ma'am. You're a mother. And some of these cars can even roll. I wouldn't sell you any of these. But I went back three times. He didn't know exactly what I was looking for. And the third time, because I didn't want to tell him I had a dream and apparently you have the car I'm looking for. Mm-hmm. The third time I went back, he said, look, ma'am, all I have is this Xerox printout of a car that isn't even being marketed yet. Mm-hmm. It's in production. And I looked at it. It was a combination of a minivan and a smaller car called an SUV. This was the first SUV. And I said, that's the car. Mm. It turned out to be designed by a woman. It had everything I wanted. I ordered it before it was even off the assembly line. And it was called a rendezvous, which I thought was great.
Oh, right. I'll meet you in my dreams.
Exactly.
Oh, my goodness. That's so practical. And that's and yet, you know, who would have known that that was coming? Apparently, the dreams did talk about nonlinear time. That's, there was something there.
Exactly. Yeah. It picked up what was in the zeitgeist. Uh-huh. Yeah. And one of the things that I thought was particularly interesting about it, too, is that the pressure had to mount. My need for an answer really mounted to the day I needed to give back that car. And that's one of the things that we can all do, is we can focus our attention on wanting that answer from our dreams. Mm-hmm. We can, before we go to sleep, write in our journal the question, write it three times. Mm-hmm. Say to ourselves, I will have a dream in the morning. I want an answer to this. Mm. And if we continue to do that and then we really pay attention to the dreams, we will find, sometimes speaking in metaphor, puns, we will find the answer.
Oh, interesting. So this is that's a kind of recipe for incubation to increase your desire. I like the word longing. I love the word longing.
Exactly.
So something like bringing up that emotional yearning.
Mm. Exactly.
Need.
And yes. And knowing that we're in a relationship with the unconscious, which is a reservoir of all the potentialities that we have. Mm. So I love that word yearning too. We're yearning for those answers and guidance. Mm. So here's a more collective one, and I may have spoken about this before, which is we have a lot going on in our world right now, and my dreams began to pick this up. Actually, my group, I was running a group in 2000, and people were having a lot of dreams about airplanes flying inside of buildings. Oh. One had an image of an airplane flying upside down. And so the first time I ever went to the International Association for the Study of Dreams, the IASD, I gave a talk about precognitive dreams of 9/11. Mm-hmm. I had no idea, of course, what these dreams were talking about until the event happened and then could trace it backwards. So sometimes you recognize precognitive dreams in retrospect. Although you can often tell there's a quality to precognitive dreams.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they tend to be more intense and more colorful. They tend to really get your attention. Very often you'll wake up and say, that was a different kind of dream. Mm-hmm. And just to give you an example of one of those, in 2012, I had a dream in which I was in the Empire State Building, talking to a dream teacher, Robbie Bosnick. And in the next moment, I was in the ocean and I knew the Empire State Building would be knocked over by a tsunami. When I woke up from this dream, I knew it was a collective dream. It wasn't just personal. It was hugely emotional. The intensity of it was different than, if you call an average dream, I never think of dreams as average, but than your usual dreams. And when I woke up, I said, oh my goodness, there is an enormous change coming to the United States. And I just worked with the image of the Empire State Building and said the state of the empire is going to be knocked over by a huge tsunami. The empire is in the process of decline. And I was writing all that in 2012, sort of feeling a bit like Cassandra, because if anybody knows that mythical figure, she gets precognitive awareness, but nobody wants to listen because it's hard to hear those things. But then, of course, when the Me Too movement happened, again, in 2012, from that dream, I said, our institutions are going to be shaken to their foundations. And that's what we've been experiencing with wave after wave.
Absolutely. I was going to say there's more. There's Me Too, but there's a lot of other things that have happened between now and then, 2012, that have really shaken us, our foundations of the empire.
Absolutely. Mm. Our democratic ways have been shaken to the foundations, and not always in a bad way, because it makes us review and recommit. But there's been wave after wave, I think, that has shaken our foundations. Mm. And also, of course, climate change. It was about the waves rising, and also the rise of the feminine and the decline of patriarchal values being dominant. Mm.
Yeah, those are all huge changes. And even the word empire for me feels very patriarchal. It's very hierarchical as well, which is kind of a hallmark of the patriarchy in my understanding, my experience of that.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. And I've been having a series of those, which, again, a little bit of a sky is falling, but I don't want to go into them now, because I do think they also warn us in order for us to take care of ourselves.
Yeah.
The Bible has many stories of precognitive dreams, like Joseph's dream, or Joseph's interpretation of the Pharaoh's dream about 7 years of fat cows and 7 years of thin cows. Mm. And what Joseph told the Pharaoh is, you will have 7 years of abundance followed by 7 years of scarcity. So you will want to prepare for that during your time of abundance.
Right. And I do think that's one thing that dreams really are doing for us, is always preparing us for what's to come. You know? And that's extremely valuable. And you know, there's some reason that everybody dreams, that all mammals dream. That is something extremely important evolutionarily, and maybe part of that is preparing us. So it would be interesting to speculate if there's like a little link even outside of time. You know, you don't have to go that far to postulate, but why not have a little tendril where we get to kind of get a little insight into what's coming next? And I think some people are more prone to prescient dreams than others. And but I'm not opposed. If their dreams want to prepare me, I would love to be prepared.
I would like to say that I never considered myself psychic, but I am a dreamer. And because I'm a dreamer and I listen and pay attention to dreams and have been doing that for a long time, the prescient dreams began to come. And I think it's because psyche or spirit or nature knows that we're listening. So they're going to start sending us dreams that are important to be listening to about ourselves, each other, our world. So I would love to share a couple dreams that my mother had.
Let's do that right after the break, because I really want to get to this, and I want to have lots of time to share about your mother and the dreams around that. And it's something that I'm very interested in the dreams of the dying and of the caretakers of the dying, that there's a way that when we are close to that portal, whether it's us or others, that maybe more can come through there. But first, I'm going to play a little piece of music. And I think if I got it right, then this is the music that you requested on your mom's behalf.
Last night I had the strangest dream I never dreamed before. I dreamed the world had all agreed to put an end.
So this is the Dream Journal, and you are indeed listening to The Squid, 90.7 FM. And our guest today is Lauren Schneider. Welcome back.
Oh, Katherine, thank you for playing that. Yeah. My mother was raised us on Pete Seeger and was an anti-war activist. Mm. So because we are connected at the level of dream, I think it's important that we listen to each other's dreams about us as well, because it can be very helpful in terms of giving us information about the relationship, how to care for ourselves. So Mom had a couple of dreams several years ago, and she would share her dreams with me, and this is the one that really first got my attention, is she shared that she had a nightmare. And in the dream, she's on an airplane. I am in a seat next to her, and my brother's in the seat on the other side. And the plane's not doing so well. It's starting to go down. And she says there's lightning and thunder outside of the plane, and all of a sudden, my hair catches on fire.
Oh.
And so she tries to put the fire out, and then she takes off her shirt. She thinks, maybe I should have taken it off sooner, and she tries to smother the fire on my head. And the flight attendant comes on the loudspeaker and says, it's okay, her mother and brother are trying to smother the fire. So when Mom shared the dream with me, of course, I asked her what that meant to her first, because I always check in with the dreamer first. And she said it was scary because if something happened to you, what would happen to me? So I didn't share my thoughts about the dream with her, but when I came home, I shared them with my husband. And I said, you know, I know from this dream that my mom's going down. She's declining. Her dementia's getting worse. And I believe that the lightning is also catching my hair on fire is also about my having awareness of what's happening to her. And she doesn't want to have conscious awareness of her decline. She doesn't want to have conscious awareness of her dementia. She won't admit it or get it treated. So she will try to smother the fire on my head. She will also project all of her anger and fear onto me. And my husband and I have worked with many children of survivors. My mom is a survivor. And there are many who have died before their parents because they have a relationship in which they have to rescue their parents. And that was true of my longtime relationship with my mom. So her dream was a gift to me because what it said to me is, I could go down with the plane too. And I don't want that in my life. I don't want to make that choice. And so I brought in a social worker based on her dream. I brought in help so that I could have an advocate for her as well as take care of myself. And it was the best decision I made. And I believed that unconsciously she had actually taken her shirt off for me. She had given me the warning. And shared the dream so that I could take care of myself as well as help in this process.
Well, and that inspired you to take this concrete action of getting some help for the whole situation, for her as well as for you. Get some more people, a social worker in this case.
Exactly. Because, you know, also fire in my head is, you know, my own anxiety and You know, my health was starting to go down, and I had been rescuing my mom throughout my life. So this was a huge warning. And again, I just took it as at the unconscious level, she was sharing something as a warning to me that she wasn't going to be conscious of, but I could be.
I'm interested in what you were saying, Lauren, about children of survivors. Can you say a little more about that? What do you...
Sure.
Yeah.
So... very often, because parents who are survivors have been so traumatized, their children feel that they have to emotionally take care of their parents. Also, physiologically, people who have had extreme trauma carry a high level of cortisol in their bodies, and that passes on to the next generation. So children of survivors have a heightened alarm system. What happens as parents, survivors, get closer to the end of life is that the children who have grown up with this expectation to help their parents save their parents can no longer save their parents from death. And so the anxiety for them, the overwhelming feeling of failure, and the unbearable, they have been their parents, you know, they have been the parents to their children. So the unbearableness of losing them oftentimes has caused the children of survivors to die first. We've seen that a lot.
You mean like the stress of it or
the stress of it? Yeah.
Oh, wow.
No.
Oh,
yes. Sometimes.
Yeah. Oh gosh. Well, you know, that's, I feel really tender about that. You know, there's like, you know, this way that our my parents were children of the Depression, and they both survived some pretty really difficult times and a lot of very difficult family situations. And you know, my family situation, I felt nurtured and supported, but there was some things that were missing for me that that really, that what you're talking about helps to explain that, and that they, you know, they bridged the gap, and they were not abusive to us, but there was a lot of tension in the family.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, my husband's parents are survivors, and I realized through them there's a lot of hope for a survivor to have the next generation. There's a resilience there. There is the belief that love could be carried forward, but they're also carrying a lot of trauma. And so that darkness and tension, which often isn't talked about in the family, mm-hmm. is felt. And felt in terms of a kind of, not a neglect, but something's missing in mm-hmm. terms of the parents' ability to be fully emotionally present.
Right, right. That's ringing a lot of bells for me. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you shared one of your mom's dreams, and I think you said you also had some of your own dreams around caring for her and around her death. I wonder if you'd like to share some of those.
Sure. Yeah. Well, it was a challenging relationship with my mom, mm-hmm. And I also was the only one that was still caring for her. My younger brother, who in the dream of the plane was on the plane with her,
yeah.
did die at 40. Of suicide.
Oh,
and so my older brother had not had contact with her. I was the last child standing, and it was quite a responsibility.
Yeah.
And I worked very hard to get to a place of deep compassion for her mm-hmm. and knowing where she came from, knowing that she was carrying ancestral trauma and that that's where some of her own darkness came from. I worked hard at it and I had a very beautiful dream a couple months ago in which I was hugging and kissing her and saying goodbye to her as if I was going away to camp and I wouldn't see her for a while,
uh-huh.
as if I didn't know when I would see her next. Uh-huh. But it was so loving.
Mm.
And I knew that I had really come to a place of completion with my mom, that I had worked very hard in our relationship. And I did. I felt a lot of tenderness toward her and compassion toward her and did make sure that she was safe.
Mm-hmm.
And then my mom had shared another dream with me, so I'll go back to this, that I began to carry on her behalf.
Mm.
So maybe about 6-7 years ago, she had what I recognized as an end-of-life dream because it actually has like a modern-day version of Jacob's Ladder in it.
Uh-huh.
So in the dream, she is driving in her car. She's in the driver's seat, and her Messiah is next to her, and he's weeping and weeping and weeping.
Hmm.
She gets to the end of the road. She gives him a kiss on the head, and she gets out of the car. In the next scene, she's going up an escalator with Hasidic Jews going up and down the escalator.
Hmm.
She gets anxious, and she looks down and she sees her rabbi. He looks up at her and smiles, and she smiles, and she goes up the escalator.
Hmm.
So this was quite a few years before she's passed away, and she told me the dream and said, but why? Why is he weeping? And I said, well, Mom, you've just lost your apartment and your beautiful things and your independence.
Mm.
I think he's grieving for your losses.
Mm-hmm.
And then she would repeat the dream like a year later and ask me again, but why? Why is he weeping?
Mm.
And I said, well, Mom, you've had a lot of regrets and losses in your life. I think he's grieving for you, for all of those regrets in your life. And then again, a year later, she said, but why is he in shrouds? Why is he dressed in a shroud?
Oh, wow.
And I said, Mom, I think this is about the end of life.
Hmm.
And she said, but the Messiah is alive. He's alive in those shrouds. And I said, yeah.
Hmm.
And perhaps he's trying to show you there's life after death.
Oh, wow. Hmm.
So beautiful. This dream was of great comfort to me And especially as I was trying to find the boundaries between myself and my mom as she was coming to the end of her life, I realized she's in the driver's seat. Yeah. I'm not in the car. And she's not alone. Mm-hmm. She does have her spirit,
right,
her Messiah with her. And she also, I don't have to carry her grief for her, which I had been doing. Mm-hmm. She is carrying the grief for her.
Right.
So I'll bring therapy into this.
Sure.
About a week, it's around March 1st, I pulled a card. Oh, let me back up for a second. I began in the last 2 years, 3 years, working with therapy on my own, diligently every day, truly as my life depended on it. I started doing it after my mom's dream about the airplane, mm-hmm. Because I knew that I needed to resolve the over-responsibility that I had for my mom. And so therapy walked me through this process of detaching with love, detaching out of a codependent relationship. And that whole process of using therapy for my own healing and growth is the last chapter of my book.
Mm-hmm.
So around March 1st, I pulled a card, and it was an image of my mom. Mm-hmm. The feathers in her hair, the hat. My mom was very stylish. Mm-hmm. This fabulous outfit. The woman in the card looked exactly like her. And she was walking along a wall, and as the wall declined, jewels were falling out.
Wow.
And I knew exactly what the card meant. My mom was coming to the end of her road. But the details of the card really struck me, that as she was coming to the portal, the ending of this life, this body, this personality, her radiance was showing up. And there were jewels that were going to be left in her wake because the walls were coming down. Again, with a survivor, there's a lot of distrust of the world and even distrust of their most intimate relationships.
Mm.
And my mom had a lot of walls. So I was really moved by this image and had the sense my mom is coming close to the end, but there are going to be jewels in her wake.
Mm.
Then on March 7th, I pulled another dream. And this dream, well, let me say that I got a copy of my paperback book. It's a proof of the book, but it was the first time I got to hold it, was on March 6th.
Exciting.
Thank you. And on March 7th, I pulled this card, and it was the sun card. Now, ordinarily, the sun would be a brilliant shining sun. It's about coming into consciousness. It's about standing in our own light. It might be about new life or joy. But this sun was being held by a great dark raven.
Mm.
And so I thought, well, there's somehow the messenger of death has eclipsed the sun here, or is holding the sun. So there's something about holding life and death simultaneously. My mother passed away the next day, mm-hmm. on the morning of my 65th birthday.
Oh, my goodness. Wow.
So my book, with this chapter about the relationship with her and my birthday and her passing, all happened simultaneously, just as the card showed.
Wow. It's very, like, synchronistic to have all those events line up.
Yeah.
Mm. So, Lauren, I want to go to our second break. This is Lauren Schneider, and we'll come back and talk more about therapy. I want to get some more details on that daily practice that you are talking about. And I also want to say at this point that the phones are open. So if you would like to phone in and join the conversation, we have Max standing by, and well, he'll tell you the drill. Give us a call. The number is 831-900-5773. This is The Dream Journal, and you're listening to K-Squid, 90.7 FM, Community Radio of Santa Cruz.
A candy-colored clown they call the Sandman tiptoes to my room every night, just to sprinkle stardust and to whisper, go to sleep, everything is all right. I close my eyes, then I drift away.
So this is now the time for call-ins. We have one in process. We'll probably only be able to take one at a time today. So I will make it another announcement when the phone line is free. So Lauren, hello. Yeah, maybe you want to, I'm very curious about your, that practice of the daily card. Is that what you're saying? That you, like, as a,
yes,
as a kind of a ritual or kind of a practice. Tell me a little bit more about how you do that.
So this is my morning ritual. It's a spiritual practice where, just like writing down dreams so that I can listen to the deeper wisdom, because I do believe that our deeper psyche, our unconscious, knows who we are and who we're meant to be, and it'll guide us. The same thing happens with the cards. These images have come from the same pool as dreams. Mm. And even these random selections have this uncanny way of giving us a picture of who we are or where we're going. Mm-hmm. And so I will either pull one card in the morning or I will do several. I like to lay out cards like a picture window. You know, imagining like a French window with several panes.
Mm, okay.
I may lay three cards out in three rows or columns, and then look at them like a picture of how they're evolving. And I'll even work the cards, because you know how with dreams we can go back with our imagination into a dream with our eyes open and active imagination. We can change a decision in a dream, or we can change the ending of the dream and interact in such a way that helps us to have more empowerment. You can do the same thing with the cards. You can change a card in order to have another image of what it might look like for you to evolve.
So would you draw another card at that point if you wanted to change a card? Yeah.
Okay. I would.
So you follow your intuition, yeah, kind of, it sounds like, of what should happen next.
Exactly. And it's like having a dialogue with your deeper self. So if I feel that a card is something I might be struggling with, then I'll be in a conversation by saying, well, what would it look like if it were better? What would it look like if I were healed?
And then draw a card.
And then I'll pull a card.
I see. So, Lauren, we have on the phone with us Ray. Hello, Ray.
Hi, Katherine.
Hi, Ray.
Hey, Ray.
Hi, Ray.
Thanks for calling. I always love it when you call.
Well, thanks. Thanks for your wonderful program.
Oh, you're so welcome. Ray's from Westside, Santa Cruz. And what do you have for us today?
Wonderful.
Yeah.
It's. I'd like some help with this dream fragment that I had two nights ago. And what's interesting to me, another thing that's interesting to me is that it's the second time I've had a similar theme show up just in the past maybe 4 or 5 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
And when this fragment starts, the setting is kind of a large room, maybe like a cafeteria, something like that, where people are eating. And there's some kind of a food bar, buffet style, you know, where people can fill their own plates. And people have been eating at tables. But when my fragment starts, I come into this, and most of the folks have finished eating, and a lot of them have left. And I think to myself, oh no, I'm late. And I go up to the buffet food bar, and the containers are almost all empty, or just little, you know how sometimes at a buffet, when it's done, there'll be little scraps and dried out bits and stuff.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, oh my gosh. And then the wait staff are taking these containers away back to the kitchen. And I hold out my empty plate and I ask one of the men, you know, do you have any food for me? And he says, well, I'll find something. And he takes my plate and comes back, and there's kind of a pile of maybe mashed potatoes on it. And but he looks like he scraped out of the bottom of a pan. But then he had added some meat kind of stuff on top of it. And I say, oh, no, I'm a vegetarian. I don't eat meat. And I wake up. And one of the things that was a major theme in my life for years was that I was late a lot. I didn't know I had ADD, and I'd get distracted, and I was just always showing up late. So, and I don't know if that's really central to this, to what's in this for me, that may just be a distraction. But
that's good to know.
There it is. I'm not getting the nourishment or the food that I need. Oh, another theme, another way this relates to me currently is I've been trying to gain weight because my weight is down. And so that's been a concern now for some months when I'm trying to get my weight up.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'm going to pause there.
Okay. Thank you, Ray. Yeah, thank you for sharing.
So, Ray, I'm going to just reflect on your dream with that idea of if this were my dream, this is what it makes me think about. You very insightfully noted that this dream has
I'm not hearing you.
Oh, sorry. Ray, do you hear me now?
Oh, no. We may be having a connection issue.
Is Katherine talking?
Yeah. So, can you hear me?
I hear you.
Oh, yeah. But you can't hear Lauren. Is that what's happening?
Lauren.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
I can't hear Lauren.
Well, Lauren, why don't you go ahead and I'm a little awkward, but I can translate.
Okay.
I can.
All right. Well, Ray noted that there's the dream has repeated. There's a similar theme he's noted.
So she's saying this has been a recurring dream.
So it's definitely something that wants to get his attention.
Right. Something wanting to get your attention.
And if it were my dream, I would think about the first thing that popped to mind is
I'd love
aging.
To hear what she's saying.
I'm sorry. I'll pass it on a bit at a time.
Okay.
I would think about aging. And
so she's talking about aging.
Later years.
Later years.
And the feeling that I get from it is that perhaps a sense of oftentimes resources, dreams, we start having dreams about not having resources as we're aging.
Resources, like not having enough resources as we're aging.
Starts showing up in dreams.
Yeah.
So that's one thing it makes
me
think about.
My wife just turned up the volume in the other room, so now I can hear.
Oh, good, good.
Oh, good.
Thank you, okay. Marcia.
I'm glad, Ray. I'm glad you can hear me.
Good thinking.
So one of the things that it makes me think about is the aging dreams, where you feel like I'm coming late, it's getting late, I'm not getting the resources that other people are getting. And the other thing that it makes me think about is how you might work with the dream is to write down some things you feel like you've been too late with. Like some regrets, because sometimes we need to just acknowledge those.
Mm.
The other thing is that they have gone back and gotten resources for you, even though it feels like you're too late. And I'm struck by the fact that they did bring out meat and potatoes. Those are really basics. Meat and potatoes.
That's kind of a metaphor when people say, oh, it was meat and potatoes. It's like, this is the basics. Although as a vegetarian, right. Ray, you have transformed what that means to you. You know, as far as like literal meat and literal potatoes. But the kind of the metaphor of meat and potatoes is like the basics.
The basics. Mm-hmm. And that's something I would pay attention to in terms of how are your basics needs being met? How is perhaps, and I would also pay attention to this physically, because if you're trying to gain weight, there may be some way in which you need the very basics of the food chain. You might even need some protein, more protein.
Mm-hmm.
Because cooks often know what's needed, right? Cooks in the kitchen. I also...
You're talking about dream cooks, Lauren? Like the dream
cook?
Yeah,
exactly.
Okay,
exactly.
I had to think about that for a second.
Exactly. Right. So this cook has brought out meat and potato. Somehow saying, this is the basics, even though it feels like you're getting from the bottom of the barrel. And I would maybe look at a belief system about how am I getting from the bottom of the barrel? How have I felt like I haven't been as abundant? But my needs are being paid attention to, and I had to speak up. This made me speak up.
Mm-hmm. Which is a powerful thing, and I think that's very good that you did that in the dream, because so often we just kind of go, oh, well, I guess there's nothing for us. But you were like, I need some food. So that's I appreciate that. So how's this landing for you, Ray?
It's wonderful. It's powerful. I'm appreciating hearing these insights. Lauren, thank you. Thank you for relating to aging. I appreciate the avenue that I can look at regrets. I think that's a powerful thing at my stage of life in particular, and get complete with those and just acknowledge, yeah, okay, I did the best I could at each point in time. And I like the idea of staying focused on the fact that my basic needs are being met, and I can perhaps increase that that flow of my basic needs being met.
And finally, the solution of speaking up for what you want, for exactly what you need. I need nourishment. What does that look like? What kind of nourishment do you need to speak up for?
Oh, I like that.
Well, there certainly are a lot of different protein options available that are still vegetarian. That I don't know if the dream is offering some specific advice in protein and starch. Like, is there something specific here that if this were my dream, I'd be asking myself, is there something I can do to expand my nutrient intake in those two categories, but in ways that I feel are appropriate, that are, you know, respectful of the ecosystem and all the reasons that I am vegetarian. So, but those specific protein, starch, are there ways that more of that would benefit me?
I use plenty of protein powder.
Yeah. Well, maybe there's other. Maybe the dream is wanting more.
Right.
Yeah. Ray, I have one more quick thought. It's kind of a weird intuition about the dream. I would wonder if you were raised on meat and potatoes.
Oh.
And.
Actually, I was raised a vegetarian.
Yeah.
Really? Oh my.
Huh.
Oh, that's
third generation.
Okay.
Oh, that's so interesting. Wow. Then I'm stumped. I want to explore that more.
Right. Oh, well, so that's interesting. Okay, well, if we follow Lauren's thought about, like, the childhood connection, and if the childhood was all vegetarianism as well, and that I am now being presented with something that, well, here's the question. How do you feel about potatoes? Do you eat potatoes, or are you?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Okay. So, you know, this is, but the meat is what's new. In dream.
Yeah, well, we have lots of new meat, in quotes, you know, meat substitutes available now, too.
It's true, the Impossible Burgers and things like that, and which have considerable amount of protein, and you know, maybe your body's just not digesting the particular powder you're doing right now, or something, you know, just to be specific, which is maybe more specific than I need to be.
Well, one other thought, then. You gave me, you flipped the dream on me.
Uh-huh.
If you're in a cafeteria, but this is about the collective, and you've always felt that you're late, or you always felt perhaps that you're not getting what other people are getting. And I'm wondering, as a third generation vegetarian, you're not eating the same thing that the collective's eating. You aren't, you're sort of outside the collective, but I'm now flipping the dream and thinking, you weren't late, you were ahead of your time.
Oh, interesting.
You were ahead of your time in anticipating your family, anticipating what this world would need, which is to cut back on our meat and potatoes.
Which we definitely need to do as a culture, as a collective.
Because we're scraping the bottom of the barrel of that, of our resources in that. And so I'm just wondering if that belief of always being late or always being a little bit outside of what others are getting could really be re-examined in terms of you being ahead of your time.
Hmm.
Oh, that's powerful for me. Visionaries.
Yeah.
Because I often felt outside, partly because of my religious background and also being a vegetarian. I remember in the 60s when a good friend of mine became a vegetarian, and I thought, oh, I know all about this. This is how I was raised. This is easy.
So that would be like new for you to have somebody like switching to your diet. And Lauren is absolutely correct that as a society, we would be way better off eating a lot less meat and following your lead and your family's lead. I really am impressed by your family that for three generations has been vegetarian. And that I think that may well be the wave of the future. I think that's what we need going forward to conserve our resources and protect our planet.
Yeah, the planet sure needs it.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Well, Ray, thank you.
Bless you, Ray.
Thank you. Yes. I've got a lot to work with here.
Wonderful. Okay. Well, take good health to you, and I'm so glad you called.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much to both of you.
All right. Thank you, Ray.
Bye, Katherine. Bye, Lauren.
Bye. Yeah, I love bringing in the collective element there. Thank you for doing that, Lauren, because it's so true.
Yeah, well, the setting is often so important in a dream, and, you know, he really set it within a cafeteria, so that whole collective element is right there.
Mm-hmm.
And his relationship to the collective is in the dream.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, you know, we have just a few more minutes. I wonder, do you want to talk a little bit more about the collective? I mean, that's the other option is we could go talk about your book, which is just being released. We have about 2-3 minutes.
Okay. Well, yeah. I don't know which way to go.
I know. That's always the thing with the show. There's always so many things that open up. And, you know, I guess let me just ask a quick question about the collective.
Please.
It's like, is there a way that we can kind of recognize that? Or is that just the kind of question we should keep in the back of the mind with every dream? Like this dream, I mean, I guess it was a collective because there was the cafeteria.
Great question.
But yeah.
So when I run dream groups, I always listen to the dream on numerous levels, which is, you know, what's going on internally for someone, that the whole dream is an internal landscape.
Mm-hmm.
What is going on in relationships so that we don't just make somebody in the dream a projection of ourselves, but literally what is happening in your relationship with that person? What are you picking up about that person? And then I would look at it collectively. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't have to be like a glaring symbol like the cafeteria to say that it's collective, mm-hmm. but that there's always some aspect of the dream that is... How is this picking up something about my environment?
Mm.
I'm trying to think of an example. Well, dreams that my group was having 20 years ago, there were 8 women in the group, and I think 7 out of the 8 had dreams about Africa and water being scarce. And so we began to listen to, again, precognitive dreams of we're needing to pay attention to water as our next issue.
Mm.
And we're beginning to see that show up now.
Sure enough.
Where water is a scarcity.
That's so true. So just something to keep in mind pretty much with every dream. I like that. So Lauren, why don't you tell, is your book now available? What is the status of, and tell us the title and how our listeners can get it.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's called Therapy. It's all in the cards.
Mm-hmm.
It will be available in early April. It is about my work as a psychotherapist because what I did was I integrated psychotherapy practices, hypnotherapy, dream work with using cards. And then, as I said before, it's also about my own practice interwoven so that people could understand that you can be a healthcare practitioner, you can be a layperson, you can use this for clients, you can use this for your own contemplative practice. The book is directed toward anybody, tarot enthusiasts, people who have had no experience with tarot whatsoever, as I said, professionals and non-professionals. And it starts with showing that, like dreams, these images connect to the unconscious.
Mm-hmm.
and bring up metaphors and help you to have insights about what's going on at a deeper level.
Right.
Like showing pictures of ourselves, just like the dreams do.
Right. And we talked about several examples of this with your clients and with yourself in previous episodes with Lauren Schneider, which you can look at for ksqd.org/the/dream-journal. And you can look up on Google Lauren Schneider there and find out more about some of that. I'm excited about the book coming out. And maybe
Thank you, me too.
Tell some folks about your web pages and how people can get in touch with you.
Sure. So I'm just in the process of putting up a new website. It's been dreamsandtarot.com. It's going to dreamsandtarotby.com. People can get a hold of me also by my email, ldreams, ldreamz@sbcglobal.net. They can also call me. I'm pretty available, 310-291-6406.
Wonderful. And you're in California, right? You're the Santa Barbara area?
I'm in Santa Barbara area. Right now, like most of us, I work on Zoom, and I do consultations with dreams and therapy. Mm-hmm. And therapy is really valuable, too, for people who don't remember their dreams. It gives us that same access to that deep unconscious wisdom.
Mm.
So it's just like having a dream with your eyes open.
Mm. I love that. Lauren, again, it's a pleasure, and we'll definitely have you back. I so appreciate everything that you do, Lauren, and the conversation today. This was very fascinating for me. Thank you.
Thank you. It was wonderful always to talk to you.
All right. Thank you. Well, take care.
You too. All right.
Bye now.
Bye.
So next week, join us, and we'll be talking to Alyssa Spungen, who is with the Institute for Dream Studies. We'll be talking about her experiences with co-incubation and how dreams have shown her that there is more than linear time, which is something we talked today with Lauren about as well. And next week, we'll also be talking about how dreams can bring us the gift of awe. So you listen live next Saturday at 10 a.m. or catch the podcast replay, which, as always, will be released on the Monday following the show.
Sweet dreams till sunbeams find you. Sweet dreams that leave all worries far behind.
I am Katherine Bell, and this has been The Dream Journal. Thanks for listening. You can find out more about my dream coaching practice at experientialdreamwork.com, and you can email me at katherine@ksquid.org. That's katherine@ksqd.org. Do contact me for a free introductory dream consultation. If you like this show, you can leave us a review on Apple Podcasts or tell a friend how much you are enjoying the show. I'd also like to thank my program assistant, Max Deaton, and our creative musician, Rick Kleffel, who created an original composition for our ambient music again today. And thank you so much to all the generous donors who support this station. K-Squid is 100% listener-supported, and donations are always welcome at ksqd.org. When you wake up tomorrow morning, take a minute to look within. Do you remember a dream? Write it down and bring it to the next Dream Journal. I am Katherine Bell, and you are listening to KSQD Santa Cruz.